Yes, Chief. I have arrived. That is no time. Thank you. We have arrived at the crime scene at exactly 5:13 p.m. Today is October 18, 2021. The weather has been quite gloomy since 3 days ago because it's been raining. And we just hope that no liquid evidence had been diluted so that laboratory analysis would not be compromised later on. We have been notified about a possible homicide. A neighbor reported screaming at around 4:30 p.m. and saw a man coming out of the Goldberg residence. So we have to secure the area to prohibit the entry of any unauthorized personnel. I will let the forensic photographer do his work right now while I cordon the house. Please wait with us here. Mrs. Goldberg. I think we're ready to go. So before we enter the crime scene, we have to ensure that we will not bring any contaminants. As a precautionary measure, we have to put some removable shoe covers and disposable latex gloves. I'm alone today because the others have been deployed at a larger, more complex crime scene nearby. So, thanks for joining me. I have a hunch, but I'll not let that interfere by now. Let me tag the evidence first. It is important that we keep everything noted. Before that, however, I'll cordon the core crime scene.
Cordoning the crime scene, the core crime scene, is crucial in ensuring that the chain of custody will be unbroken. I am not expecting any reinforcements right now as I am assigned to this case alone. So this step will prevent any unauthorized personnel from entering. Preservation is another key task of a crime scene specialist. I will later be collecting evidence and I want to keep an accurate image before altering anything. I conducted some relevant measurements and I also noted observations that may be critical to the case.
I'll start numbering the evidence now.
Take multiple swabs when you have a blood pool.
We let the swab air dry so that no microorganism can grow in this sample. So now I'll keep it here in this specimen container and then later label it accordingly. I will take now the gun and I will note how I saw it. So it's in that direction.
Using a stylus, I inscribed my initials onto the gun's surface, particularly in an area that would not destroy the value or appearance of the weapon.
As much as possible, I have to treat it as a loaded gun, so I have to point it away from me and from the victim's body. So I have to secure that there is no moisture before I put it in so that possible fingerprints will not be erased. I also have to check if the gun is loaded, put on the safety pin. Evidence number three is a paper cup with apparently a lipstick mark. So it has some kind of liquid. We have to take a sample of that liquid and put it in the specimen container first. Seeing that we don't have a dropper, we just have to ensure that
we can get a sufficient, substantial amount of the liquid so we can submit it for testing later on. As for the paper cup, we have to drain the contents and dry it. There are no more contents. So I can put it inside the paper envelope now. This could be our murder weapon, but unfortunately, we don't have any more specimen container for this swab. We have to improvise. Preferably, we should opt out of plastic containers to avoid moisture and hence possible bacterial growth, but since we don't have that, I'll just use a Ziploc. I will just ensure to air dry and to keep the Ziploc shut as a precautionary measure. So now, let me take a swab. I'll air dry this for a while.
Ideally, well-ventilated boxes or paper bags should be utilized for blood samples. Later, we can poke holes before securing these in their outer paper packaging.
As for the knife, we also have to air dry it, and that will take a while. The knife is a very dangerous weapon, and this procedure should not be missed in order for the sharp object to stay stable during transfer to the nearest police station. As much as possible, we have to avoid hurting ourselves. If that happens, our blood will mix with the victim or the suspects. Now it has been properly secured. So as for the fifth evidence, it's an underwear. The blood has dried up, but it seems as though the semen is still here. We must take a swab. Again, we don't have any remaining specimen container for this. We will do the same procedure as in the previous blood specimen. So we'll keep a swab of this. And allow it to air dry for a bit. The swab is already air dried. We have to put it inside this Ziploc.
We can also prevent condensation by allowing air to leave the Ziploc.
As for the underwear, it's already dried. We can now put it inside a paper envelope. I already changed my gloves because I don't want to put any of the blood and semen specimen in this evidence, so I'll just pick it up and then put it in the envelope. Now we have to seal these containers and continue with the labeling.
Securing the bags tightly, preferably using evidence tape, is highly necessary. I put my initials and the date of collection over the seal as an assumption of responsibility. Broken seals may indicate contamination.
So we need to be as thorough and as accurate as possible when filling out the information. Leaving our initials would not be enough, as that would not be able to help our people in the police office. Marking the packaging thoroughly can aid us in the laboratory analysis and may serve as proof of chain of custody. I just hope we can find the killer soon. Justice shall be served. I'll make sure that happens. Kindly leave first. I'll do a final documentation and observation to see if I missed something. Thank you for waiting. Upon careful examination of the scene of the crime, we have gathered six important pieces of evidence. The blood pool found beside the neck of the victim. A knife, plastic cup, underwear with suspected seminal fluid and blood, a pistol, and a wallet containing the identification card, debit cards, and bills of the victim.
I have signed as the collector of all six identified evidence, and I will be the one to deliver these items to the nearest police station, the Manila Police, and I will let the recipient sign their name and the date and time of receipt so that we have proof of proper chain of custody or anti-contamination.
Thank you so much, and I'll see you there.
Me Meanwhile, the evidence custodian, Officer Rafaela Quiñones, does the inventory for the evidence upon my delivery. She signs as the recipient and writes the date and time of receipt. She counts and tracks the items she has received and later compares her list with mine.
Now it's time for the ugly truth. It was different from my initial theory, my hunch. Thanks to eyewitness testimonies, it became easier to clean the mess. We tagged this as a rape with homicide, but laboratory results and forensic autopsy beg to disagree. You see, it was not just a mere stabbing incident. We saw two common murder weapons in the crime scene, a pistol and a knife. They ruled out suicide. Ballistics reported no gunpowder residue. The gun was registered to Mr. Goldberg, who passed away 5 years ago. There were no fingerprints other than Mrs. Goldberg's. The knife had a unique set of fingerprints, which were owned by Mr. Jacob C. He was a butcher at the meat market, and he recently got into an argument with Mrs. Goldberg regarding an expired order. The specimen collected from the knife were a mix of human and pig blood. DNA testing confirmed that the former was Mrs. Goldberg's. If our team members were incompetent, we might have convicted Mr. C for rape with homicide immediately. However, we interviewed the suspect and found that he had a solid alibi, which could be corroborated by the CCTVs outside Mrs. Goldberg's apartment and at the market parking lot. The underwear was unfortunately part of the eerie and unthinkable ploy to create the perfect crime. Autopsy noted that the victim had no recent sexual intercourse. The clear, mucus-like substance was not seminal fluid. A simple analysis verified that it was a mere face serum. The blood stain was dried for a reason. It was just a lip tint in the shade of burgundy, coated with iron oxide powder to mimic the rusty scent of blood. What the suspect forgot is that the powder could be traced back to him. Our team identified the characteristics of the iron oxide powder and found that it is unique in a sense that some food coloring had been added to it. Furthermore, we found the packaging in the trash can outside the Goldberg residence. Only one store in the entire country sold impure iron oxide of the same kind, Tracy's Craft Essentials. The wallet was a key piece of evidence. It had a photograph of an infant taken in 1995. Other than that, all of Mrs. Goldberg's registered cards were found in the slots. It seems like robbery was not the intended action. We identified the last and guilty suspect through the cup and its content. The lipstick mark was indeed Mrs. Goldberg's, but there were fingerprints of a certain Mr. Joseph Quinn. Facial recognition revealed that Mr. Joseph Quinn was the same man in the baby photograph. Regarding the clear watery liquid we found, it was not water. There were traces of aconite. We surveyed the locality and found that the only person who owned wolfsbane or aconitum plant was Mr. Joseph Quinn. He was the last to buy the iron oxide at Tracy's Craft Essentials too. His physical attributes matched with descriptions provided in the witness testimony. Mr. Quinn was seen leaving his place of work at 3 p.m. The surveillance footage showed him entering the Goldberg residence at 3:17 p.m. Toxicology reported that Mrs. Goldberg died due to aconite poisoning. As per her relationship with Mr. Quinn, it's best to keep it a secret for now.